Okay. So, relative extrema appear on the graphs as peaks and valleys. That's kind of the non-mathematical way of describing it. As with x-intercepts, the maximum number is related to the degree. So with polynomials, okay, so what was I saying? Polynomial functions. Okay, the maximum number of extrema, now this is just the maximum, it's not the guarantee, but the maximum number is related to, and I don't have it written up there, I need to write it up there. It is the degree minus one. So if you have a quartic function, x to the fourth plus 5x cubed plus yada, 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 the degree is 4, then it's going to have a maximum of 3 maximums slash minimums, some combination of those. Okay, so it's the degree minus 1 is your maximum number of extrema. They are most common with polynomial functions, okay, but they can exist for rational functions as well, but those are the only ones. We'll talk about why they don't exist for radical and exponential and logarithmic in a minute. But we really only have to deal with it with polynomial and sometimes rational functions. So, the technical definition of a relative minimum is that when you're looking from left to right, as you start on the left side of the graph and you move towards the right side of the graph, if your function changes from decreasing to increasing, that creates a minimum, a relative minimum. A relative maximum is the opposite. When you're moving from left to right, if your function changes from increasing to decreasing, you've hit a maximum point. Now, that's pretty obvious. You've dealt with this before, but you may not have talked about it specifically in these terms. And for those of you who continue on the calculus, this is how we talk about it a lot. So that's why I wanted to go ahead and introduce it that way.
Okay, so when you determine those relative extrema, where they occur, you can talk about the intervals of increasing and decreasing because you change at those extrema,
okay? Because a change occurs at the extrema.
For most functions, you're going to have to rely on your calculator, but for quadratic functions, we can actually find the maximum and the minimum by hand.
And you should have done this before in the past. This should look somewhat familiar.
But here's your general form of a quadratic function, ax squared plus bx plus c. You're familiar with these coefficients because of the quadratic formula and whatnot. Well, to find the vertex of a parabola, that could be the maximum or the minimum. It depends on what type of, whether it's, it faces upward or if it opens downward. The vertex, the x-coordinate, can be found by doing negative b over 2a. So b being the coefficient in front of the x, you change its sign, and you divide by 2 times the coefficient in front of the x squared. Kind of looks like a part of the quadratic formula. True? After you find the x value, then you're going to plug it into the function to get the y value of your vertex. Okay? So we're going to look at an example that is a quadratic function whose graph is a parabola. It has either a maximum or a minimum, and we'll talk about which one it is, without looking at the graph. And then we will look at a higher degree polynomial example as well. Okay.
It is a
chip. Okay, let's go to number two. Number two is a quadratic function. Okay, oh, thank you. Number two is a quadratic function, so let's find the vertex of this quadratic function. Alright, so the x coordinate is negative b over 2a. So a in this case is 1. There was no coefficient in front of the x squared, so it's 1. B is the coefficient in front of the x. You need to include the negative. So
Negative B means you change the sign of B. So that's positive 8 over 2 times 1. So this has a x coordinate of 4 is the vertex. Okay. We need to find the y coordinate of the vertex. So we go back in and we plug in 4 for x into the equation. So we get 16 minus 32 plus 16. Well, guess what? That's 32 minus 32, that's 0. The y coordinate is 0. So this has either a maximum or a minimum at 4, 0. Well, how do we determine which one it is? Anybody know? Okay. Without putting it in the calculator, we look at the coefficient a. If a is positive, then you have an upward facing parabola. So that means that this point 4, 0 is a minimum. So it's a minimum at 4, 0. So that means, let's talk about the increasing and decreasing as well. Okay, this function, looking at it, I'm pretty sure you can tell me that the left side of this is decreasing and that the right side is increasing, but let's actually write that in interval notation. Now, when we're talking about this, we're moving from left to right, so we use the x coordinates to describe this. Okay, we use the x coordinates to describe this. So from the left, from negative infinity until we get to the point 4, x equals 4, what is our function doing? It is decreasing. So it is decreasing from negative infinity to positive 4, and then it is increasing from 4 to positive infinity.
So it's continue increasing over here on the right side until it is positive infinity. Okay? So we did all that without a calculator because we can calculate vertex by hand. Looking at the coefficient of A, we can determine whether it's facing up or down. We draw that without a calculator. Now, if we're looking at something like number 5 that's of a higher degree, we cannot do it by hand.
Okay, we have to rely on our calculator for this one. So I'm going to type. meaning more than a quadratic, more than degree 2. Okay? Because it was positive x squared, so it's facing upward, so that vertex is going to be at the base of the parabola. If it's negative x squared, it faces downward, so that vertex is a maximum. Okay, so let's type this in to our y equals. And that.
Okay, this one has 3 relative extrema. And you probably already got, I think y'all already have this one graphed on your paper. Rough sketch of it, but you can see there's a minimum here, there's a maximum here, and there's a minimum here. So we need to go through
and we need to second trace. We'll start with the minimums. Number 3 is the minimum, so we need to move our cursor over here to the left, move it to the right. We have a min at, let's do this accurate to 3 numbers after the decimal place. So negative 1.656, negative 2.48. Okay, that is 1 minimum. We have another minimum over there, but I'm going to go ahead and find that maximum since it's in between the two. Maximum. The maximum is at, okay, so check this out.
Don't just start writing down these numbers without looking at the entire number. Here's that weird thing, e to the negative 6. First of all, you should notice, it looks like it's on the y-axis, and then it gives me 2.27. That's not on the y-axis, okay? So e to the negative 6, remember,
that's 0, okay? That is 0. 0, 3 is that maximum right there. And then we have another minimum. Pretty much, yeah. Okay, our other minimum is at 0.906, 1.955.
Alright, that's the easy part. Talking about the increasing and decreasing intervals is a little bit more difficult.
Okay, so I always start, I just write down decreasing, increasing. Usually I do increasing first, but for some reason I had decreasing in my mind. So, anyways, I start on the left side of the function. Okay, I start on the left side of the function. So starting from negative infinity until I get to that minimum, my function is decreasing. So from negative infinity to the x-coordinate of that first minimum, my function is decreasing. Then it's increasing. So from negative 1.656 to my maximum, 0, we use the x values to describe this. Then I start decreasing again. Okay, so I decrease from 0 to that second minimum, 0.906. And then from that second minimum on, my function is going to be increasing. You have to what?
You have to do every single change.
Yes, every single change. So we decrease, we increase, we decrease, and we increase. We've got four intervals, but it covers, notice, it covers our entire domain.
It goes from negative infinity all the way to positive infinity. There are no breaks in there because our domain is all over.
Okay. Let's look at a rational function really quick. Okay. So this is number 20. Rational functions are related to polynomials because rationals are built from polynomials. I would not. I would just type in the original. I mean, you've already done the simplifying work at this point, but I would type in the original function because I want to see everything that's going on with the graph. And again, remember, put that numerator in parentheses, put the denominator in parentheses. So, when we look at this graph, here on the left side, we are increasing, we're increasing, and then there's vertical asymptote right here at negative 2. Okay, you should already know that from the work you've previously done. So, we don't have any extrema here on this left side of this function. But this middle part, it kind of looks like it appears out of nowhere, but remember, it really doesn't. Okay, there's a little bit of kind of like a parabola here in the middle. So we're going to have a maximum right here. And then look at this right side of the function. It starts by decreasing on this side of that vertical asymptote. It starts by decreasing, and then as you continue on, and you can zoom out if you want to, you see that it starts to increase again. So we've got a maximum here in the middle, and we're going to have a minimum over on the right side of this function. So we can use the calculator to calculate the maximum in the middle. Okay, we have a max at negative 0.482.042 is our maximum. And we're going to have a minimum at somewhere between 3 and I'm just going to go with 7 to be on the same side. The maximum's there in the middle part of the graph. It's kind of hard to see. You kind of need to zoom in to see it a little bit more clearly. But
you can kind of see this side of the function is increasing, and then it starts decreasing. Fairly close to the origin, but not exactly on the origin. And then the minimum is over there.
Okay, so when we talk about increasing and decreasing, our function starts by increasing. So